I never thought I would be so excited to look through people's old underwear, I guess. Have you had one of those moments where you had a bit of an epiphany? Picture me browsing through books in January 2021, trying to narrow down on a dissertation topic. Or actually, maybe more accurately, I was scrolling through TikTok and saw a trend where people were buying corsets off Amazon and were surprised at the feeling of wearing a corset, mostly negatively. I started thinking about corsets, a topic well explored here on YouTube, but also thinking about how we usually defend the historical corset from the modern corset by saying, corsets were made differently back then. You should try a corset made for you, custom made. And this is right, but it's also wrong. Quick disclaimer, the following information is based on research I undertook for my master's dissertation in dress and textile history at the University of Glasgow in 2021. There may be more to report on that, but later. This perspective of the custom-made Victorian corset ignores one of the largest industrial changes in the 19th century. That is, that custom-made, small-scale corset production actually changed dramatically to become standard-sized and mass-produced. The mass-produced corset is not a 21st century invention, but a 19th century product. The move from a custom fit to a mass-produced garment had its challenges. How did they negotiate with had hitherto mostly been a custom-made or fit garment to being mass-produced, designed and made for the thousands? The corset is not like other garments. Skirts, dresses could be altered easily after purchasing, but corsets, as a finished product, are nearly impossible to alter successfully without compromising its structure. How is a perfect-fitting garment made to fit everyone? The short answer is, it's not. Through the tracking of corset advertisements, it is possible to identify that the mass-produced corset industry was actually thoroughly detailed. Through technological developments, it was possible to construct a strong product. With the mechanization of processes, production became much more efficient and faster, which allowed factories to produce greater quantities and a diversity of corset styles. This presented the market with a large offering of different corset styles, where certain styles were aimed at particular body types or figures. In conjunction with the existing sizing methods, it was possible to customize a mass-produced corset to a certain degree. Despite removing the traditional custom-made or custom-fit aspect of corsetry, mass production presented such a variety of choice in a conscientious design and marketing decision to cater to all different styles of women, that it was still possible to get a well-fitting, strong product. So what does this all mean? Let's have a quick look at the history. A very short history of the corset and corset making. Corsets have a long history that I won't pretend I can fit into 5 minutes for this video. But here is a brief overview of the relevant history. Stiffened or bone structured garments have been worn for centuries by people of all genders for different purposes. These could be for aesthetic purposes, to fit within a socially accepted fashionable silhouette, it could be to upkeep cultural interpretations of morality, or to support the body that wore them. The term bodies is often used for 16th and 17th century structured undergarments, and stays for the 18th and early 19th century. In the 19th century, the term corset arose derived from the French corps for body. This may have been because of the closeness of the corset to the body, but also how it shaped and molded the body that the person chose to present to the world. Further, French corsetry is often acknowledged across Victorian magazines as being of the best quality and most sought after. So it makes sense that a French word was adapted. Corset making is also an intricate journey. Stay making was a very specific and highly prized skill, mostly dominated by men. This work did not just include stitching, but also taking measurements, pattern drafting, cutting, fitting, cutting and preparing the boning, and making the actual thing. The field sort of changed towards the end of the 18th century because the clothing itself changed. The shape of stays softened, whalebone became scarcer in garments, and I think this correlates to an increase in female stay makers and corsetiers in the 19th century, because it was the struggle of cutting and inserting boning that often is defended as why it was mostly a male task. In the 19th century, corsets were mostly made by specific corset makers or corsetiers in smaller atelier-style settings, usually including a few extra pairs of hands. Up until the introduction of the sewing machine in the mid-century, all home and commercial sewing was done by hand, which meant each piece could easily be customized to the end consumer in the process of the making. This is not to say that there were no ready-made corsets of any sort, because there's evidence that ready-made styles and corsets existed from early on, particularly in urban settings. For example, the Ladies' Shopping Manual and Mercury album, published in 1834 by E.E. Perkins, states that in London one can procure anything and everything, and proceeds to describe the types of stays available for purchase in London. Stays were available in three colours, white, drab and nankeen, and in four materials, jean, ditto satin, drill, satin, and in four sizes, girls, maids, women's and outsize. Another option to acquire stays or corsets was to make them at home. However, corset making is different from dressmaking, and it requires a different set of skills to accomplish a good garment. This was well recognized at the time. The author of The Workwoman's Guide from 1838 writes in the introduction to the stays section, "It is impossible to give any particular patterns or sizes of stays, as they must, of course, be cut differently, according to the figure, and be variously supported with more or less bones or runners of cotton, according to the age, strength, or constitution of the wearer." The author highlights the importance of custom fitting or adjusting the patterns to the individual body, as it is impossible to standardize the patterns or sizes. I also find it really telling that she underlines the stays as a practical garment by making no mention of the desired waist or shape, and instead age, strength, and constitution, which should affect how much support the stays needed to provide. She then proceeds to advise how to arrange one's pattern. It is recommended to those who make their own stays to purchase a pair from an experienced stay maker that fit perfectly well, and also a pair cut out, but not made up, so as to be a good pattern for the homemade stays. By this method, the author instructs the reader to purchase two pairs of stays from a professional, one already sewn together and wearable that fits perfectly, and another in the exact same size and cut, but not made up, which means that the stays panels would be prepared, but not sewn together. This allowed each stays panel to remain flat and be traced or copied out to paper to make a pattern. These instructions clearly endorse the expertise of professional staymakers, and that the homemaker can only hope to imitate a professional product by taking the pattern from a staymaker's stays. This guide illustrates the limitations of making stays or corsets at home, as it required a very specific skill set, which was not necessarily inherent to all domestic makers. With the introduction of the sewing machine in the mid-century, clothing production in general changed. Clothes and corsets could be produced much quicker and in larger quantities. Small-scale atelier-style businesses grew to include more stitchers, and production in general changed to modes such as line production, allowing a faster turnaround and more efficient construction. What was once often a one-room affair with a handful of professionals often grew to include dozens of different kinds of machinery and hundreds of workers. Though the very construction and manufacture of corsets changed drastically in the 19th century, its importance in the Victorian silhouette did not. The fashionable shape was built upon the corset, which helped accommodate tight-fitting bodices and heavy skirts by supporting the body and the clothes upon it. I don't quite have the scope to go into 18th and 19th century concepts of morality and how they relate to the corset, but it was respectable for women in this time period to wear a corset. So why does it matter? The pervasive narrative that the corset was a patriarchal object, that women wore corsets to make themselves more attractive to men and the choir husbands, a rhetoric that was hotly debated in the media in the late 19th century and is popularized by 20th century historians such as Flugel, freaking Flugel, diminishes women across history. Women had interests past men, and corsets had uses past attracting men. This is why I care about corsets as a subject of research. And mass-produced corsets can give us insight into different lives that are often left out of museums and history books. Corset mass production. In my research of corset mass production, I decided to use the British company R.N.W.H. Symington as a case study for the growth from small-scale to mass production. So a little bit more about Symington's. The Symington Company started out as a family business. James Symington moved from Scotland to Market Harborough and established his own business, a tailor, hatter and woolen drapers, in the early 1830s. The shop next door was leased to Mrs. Gold, a staymaker. James Symington and Sarah Gold, the staymaker's daughter, married in 1835. Through this marriage, Sarah's skill set as a seamstress and staymaker enabled James Symington to expand his business into staymaking. In 1850, he leased the cottage which Sarah set up her workshop, employing three other young women for staymaking. Sarah's skill and work were recognized by their customers, and accordingly their business grew. Sarah and James's eldest son, Robert, traveled to America in 1855. From America, he returned with a Singer sewing machine. Its early introduction into the Symington workshop was essential in the expansion of production and increasing the rate of output, and saving much of the hard work of sewing tough fabrics by hand. Andrew Godley proposes that it was the adoption of the sewing machine in this time period that led to the 1890s remarkable production and productivity, making these decades crucial in the development of Victorian mass production businesses. In 1861, they expanded the business to part of a disused carpet factory, where they established a factory production of corsets. The brothers remained informed and current with technological developments for factory production, such as adding additional machinery for all ranges of processes within the production and replacing treadle machines with steam power when this became an option. By 1880, the local newspaper, the Midlands Times, reported that the company employed some 1,600 people and had about 500 machines running. By 1881, the company was exporting corsets internationally. Within 20 years of factory production, the company had grown to be a staple across the Midlands and supplying wholesalers, both under their own company name and unlabeled, as well as tackling the international market. The company continued to grow and produce into the 20th century, finally closing down in 1990. Yes, you heard me right, 1990. It was the industrialization and early adoption of the sewing machine that took Sarah's individual skills as a staymaker and expanded it into a hugely successful business, which spanned across several different factories and produced huge quantities of corsets, both nationally and internationally. So while this tells us the history of the industry, in one example, it doesn't tell us a lot about the actual change to the corset. With the need to streamline construction to optimize output, corset patterns were cut to standard sizes developed by expert pattern makers within the company. This was often a long process, full of trial and error. These corset patterns followed fashionable silhouettes and were offered in a range of sizes, mostly discerned by waist size, and then the rest was sorted proportionally. An important factor to keep in mind is that padding was widely used throughout the century to adapt the corset and the outer silhouette to the desired shape. So though a 28-inch waist corset would come with a 48-inch bust, this did not mean that the customer's bust was 48 inches, or that the waist was 28 inches, by the way. We have grown accustomed to hearing that fashions changed, and still do, very quickly. That is, in one season is out the next. This was not strictly true of corsets. Corset styles could last for years, and if you trace corset advertisements in magazines, you often find the same model advertised for over a decade. There were many different corset producers, each with a dozen corset models that came in half a dozen different materials, colors, and sizes to fit both you and your financial situation and your bodily needs. The shift from custom-made to mass production was most noticeable for the middle and lower classes, as custom-made corsets were still available and more popular with the upper classes. The mass production of corsets made fashionable styles more easily accessible to women with lower incomes, but it also flooded the market with many different brands, fabrics, constructions, and styles. Essentially, it flooded the market with choice. Because of the target audience of mass-produced corsets, not a lot of extants exist in public collections. Notoriously, dress collections and museums have prioritized higher-end and elitist clothing in pristine condition, which does not include your average woman's worn-in corset. Corsets were worn until they fell apart and could be mended no more, at which point they disappeared from the record. So you can imagine my happiness when I found one for sale. A working woman's corset. This corset came out for sale on Instagram right around my birthday, 2 months after I had submitted my dissertation. I bought it in an instant. I'd never seen a working woman's corset which was worn and patched online, let alone in person. So I wanted to share it with you. In case you're new to the channel, this is how I've been taught to handle antique textiles. Don't come for me. So I keep it in this archival box wrapped up in acid-free tissue paper. I have tied up my hair. I have washed my hands. There are no rings or anything that the fabrics could catch on. And there's no food, water, pens anywhere near it. And we're going to handle it with my bare hands very carefully. I love it. So this is very clearly a Victorian corset. I would say 1890s maybe. Yeah, maybe around then. And it is made... Okay. Where do we even start? It's just so beautiful. And it's so worn. And what I love about it is that there are patches everywhere. Literally everywhere. A lot of the wear is around the waist, but it's just been patched all over. And I think that's why I love it. Like, this was a well-worn corset. And you can see it's a very, very plain corset. So it doesn't have any sort of decoration, although there is indication that there might have been flossing, holding in some bones at some point. But this is the inside of the corset. As you can see, it has been worn a lot. So this corset has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 panels, no gores or gussets. And then it had a busk at the center front. So something that is very common is when you throw away something like this, you would scavenge it for whatever you can keep. And in this, what they kept was the busk. So the busk was taken out. So the seams were undone and the busk just came straight out here. And then the other thing that they took out were the bones. So there are channels here which have the indication of having had bones in them. And also the flossing is also a clue that there would have been boning here, because the flossing was often used to not just decorate but also hold boning in place. There is one tiny little piece of bone left in here, which would have been whalebone. There are ways you can test this by having a magnet. You can tell if it's whalebone or metal, but I can tell just really easily that it's whalebone because it's super flexible and light. Otherwise, this corset is fully corded. So in one of the descriptions I read, they call them runners of cotton. It's what we call cording today. And it's just the whole panels, all of it is cording, all of it, which makes a much more, makes a strong and sturdy corset, but it also makes it super more affordable. And it also makes it more comfortable, I would find. Like this one I'm wearing now has two panels on either side that are nearly fully just cording. And it does provide a lot of support without needing a lot of boning. And when I was talking with the Symington curator, something she mentioned is that Symington specialized in cording. There was its own cording department. They made the cording and the corded fabric in-house. And it also, it made really affordable corsets. It was one way to make them cheaper. It's just beautiful, you guys, I love it. There's some hand stitching where stuff has been repaired, and some machine stitching where stuff has been repaired. But it's great. There are stains, and you can see the runners of cotton, the cording coming out here. Yeah, it's just a really beautiful piece. I know it doesn't look like it probably to you, but I find this wonderful. And this is something that I wanted people to see, because when you see me here on YouTube or on Instagram with this pristine, white, beautifully embellished corset, this is because I've worn it 3 times in my life since I've made it. And I made it, I think, 3 years ago. I only wear it to do photo shoots or to put on a costume. I don't wear it every day. If I did, I would want a corset like this and it would look like this. So I'm hopefully going to be making one. I will insert some beautiful close-ups of this so you can see. I don't know what kind of other information you might want to see, but actually I've just discovered that I lied. The corset is made of 3 layers of fabric. The inside looks like a coutil, possibly like a really lightweight coutil or twill. And then on the inside, you have jute. And this, I know, is a technique that the Symington company used. And I know this because I talked to the curator, and she said the pretty house-made corset is made with jute in the middle, and most of them were, and I've bought it to make my own. So it's really cool to see it confirmed here. So this would create a pretty lightweight corset. It's 2 layers of twill or coutil. This is coutil. 2 layers of coutil and then 1 layer of jute in the middle. Someone's added a leather patch to the back. I think where a bone had broken, maybe, because there is a hole there in that channel. I never thought I would be so excited to look through people's old underwear, I guess. So half the waist of this corset measures 13 inches. So that would give you 26 inch waist plus 2 inches at the gap, 28. Mine is about 29, 30 when corseted. So, I mean, this is a pretty normal size, I'd say. I'm a UK size 14. So there we go. If you'd like a more in-depth video about this corset, let me know. I think there's way more to be done with it. I can maybe do it over on Patreon. If you're interested in that, let me know and check out my Patreon in the link below. I just love it. Okay, let's wrap this up. I know this is only the tip of the iceberg as it comes to corset and mass production and dress history, but this is a topic I find truly interesting. I'm very lucky as I'll be able to continue this research and I start a PhD on the topic in the autumn. But first, I will attempt to make a corset from Symington's collection, the Pretty Housemaid Corset, which was aimed directly at women in domestic service. I want to experiment with mass production's construction techniques and see how or if the corset feels different to other styles from the same time period that were not directly advertised as being for working women. Stay tuned.